when they're both expecting. And you see on the cover page of your bulletin a beautiful bronze statue, uncrowned, the Church of the Visitation, about 20 minutes by car from Jerusalem, where the church has remembered for thousands of years this meeting and this greeting. We hear the moment when the cousins greet each other. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb." Elizabeth then wonders how she herself could be so blessed, that God's mother has come to visit her. And as soon as Elizabeth hears Mary's voice, she says, "The baby John leaps for joy." So before Mary sings the Magnificat, Elizabeth joins her own belief with Mary's. She says, "Blessed is she," meaning Elizabeth, that there will be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord. Not only Mary is blessed, but Elizabeth too. Both women are carrying children who are unlikely for physical, economic, political, cultural, and even religious reasons. God brought surprising abundance into unlikely places. Mary's response to Elizabeth's greeting is drawn from Hannah's great song of joy. Remember Hannah, who bore Samuel after many years of longing for a child. And it's both broadly political and completely, deeply personal. The Magnificat is the proclamation of God's limitless power of liberation and reversal. But I don't know about you, but for me, over time, parts of the Magnificat have been tough to sing. It's easy to rejoice when God fills the hungry with good things, but the parts about scattering the proud in the thoughts of their hearts and bringing down the powerful from their thrones felt a little spiteful, if not short-sighted. Because after all, the mere fact of civil leadership does not necessarily mean injustice or cruelty. And the chaos of toppled governments never brings better things for anybody, not even those who are struggling. Nobody at all, but especially not those who are struggling. And I have trouble singing the part about filling the hungry with good things and sending the rich away empty. That just didn't feel abundant and generous in the way I understand God's economy. After all, I don't think that our God engaged a great plan of surprise and reversal and fulfillment just to make different people hungry and put other people on the top. That's not consistent with the abundant activity of God in the world that I see. So where was Mary in all of this? Was she an innocent teenager, swept up against her will in God's grand plan of salvation, a powerless subject of decisions made for her by others? Maybe, but only for a minute. Mary chose her response to God's invitation, focusing on the many ways in which she was blessed, not on what she lacked according to standards, understandings of the personal or economic power of a young Jewish girl in the first century. Gabriel greets Mary by name, telling her that God is with her, that she's even favored by God. And of course, Mary's not sure about any of this. Luke's gospel tells us that she was greatly troubled by his words and wondered aloud what on earth kind of greeting this was. But she hears enough. She asks good questions. She evaluates Gabriel's answers. And then she says she's all in. "I'm the Lord's servant. Let it be according to your word." In this conversation, though, the ball's still in Mary's court. What if she hadn't been home when Gabriel stopped by? What if she had to wait until the bread was out of the oven, or until she finished up a project of work, or what if she told him she'd have to get back to him? after some other things in her life got settled, like, for example, her betrothal to Joseph? What if she just said no? I wonder if God had a backup plan for human salvation. But Mary says yes to God through Gabriel, and then she lets loose with this mighty song of joy. The Magnificat is not the song of a victim of force or coercion. The Magnificat is not a song of resignation in the face of inevitable force of empire. The Magnificat is a song of triumph, fulfillment, and reversal. It's not focused on the hard parts, burying the Messiah in poverty under Roman occupation. Mary is rejoicing that God lifted her up and satisfied her hunger with good things. It's the knowing and powerful song of someone who has already entered into partnership with God. Mary doesn't mention the money and the power she doesn't have or her youth and inexperience, but instead she sings of God's favor and great abundance. And the Magnificat has a wonderful relationship and connection to our hopes here at Emmanuel Church as we live into our new lives with Newport Classical and imagine expanding our hopes to include our feeding ministry. St. Martin in the Fields in London is well known both as a concert and a recording venue for great sacred music and as a worshiping community deeply engaged in social outreach. If you ask an American person, especially somebody who grew up in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, about St. Martin in the Fields, if they listen to classical music on NPR or public radio at all, everyone will remember the name Sir Neville Mariner. This concert is conducted by Sir Neville Mariner. And that's how we know it. But in England, St. Martin in the Fields is known as a homeless shelter for the outreach ministry that is done there. I read a 2014 article by Sam Wells, the rector at St. Martin in the Fields, no relation, of course, that relates directly to the Magnificat. I read that this week. And Mary's great choice to live into abundance rather than limits of fear and scarcity. Sam Wells writes about the composer, Antonio Vivaldi, who lived from 1678 to 1741 in Venice and wrote one of the great musical settings for the Magnificat. Vivaldi was also a Catholic priest, and he worked, and he was a violinist and a Catholic priest, and he worked as the organist and choir master at a local orphanage that supported its operations through choir performances. And one of those compositions was the Magnificat, Mary's song. So how did the children in the orphanage sing Mary's song? Vivaldi composed music for the choir to perform, drawing audiences in to support the orphanage through donations and bequests. Vivaldi was giving young girls a song to sing and offering them a chance to bring their own redemption about and the liberation of others like them. They were truly singing Mary's song, incubating the gospel of transformation, just as Mary incubated the word. Vivaldi's business plan has a lot in common with the business plan of Emmanuel Church in our space collaboration with Newport Classical. We're serving as a worshiping community, a center for social outreach, and a sacred music venue. And we can live into this dynamic form of social enterprise that begins with celebrating what we do have rather than lamenting our disadvantages. It's a philosophy of abundance, like Mary's own song. And along the way, we'll practice partnership and discipline and teamwork, while remembering that our business sense and our entrepreneurial imagination are just a few things that God has given us to work with as partners with the Holy Spirit in imagining Emmanuel's future. Antonio Vivaldi created a creative partnership among charitable, cultural, and commercial cultures, finding a way to harmonize those sometimes discordant melodies. Those harmonies now can help us hear Mary's song of the great generosity of God's economy, where the lowly are lifted up and everyone is filled with good things. And who better than Emmanuel Church, the church of the people, to sing Emmanuel's own Mother Mary's song, where everyone does better and no one does worse. In a seaside metaphor more suited to our local context, a rising tide lifts all boats. What if scattering the proud in the thoughts of their hearts breaks open their hearts and allows them to see others in a new way? And what if God casts down the powerful from their thrones as an invitation to them to join the community? What if Mary's song is about the great generosity of God's economy, where the rich share their resources and go home with lighter pockets, but hearts filled with love and connection? In this Advent season, when we remember both hopeful expectation and penitence, let's ask ourselves new questions about Mary's song and see ourselves and the world.